Business today is a member's business debate on motion number 15826 in the name of Alison Johnstone on Scotland's food future. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and I'd invite those members who wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons as soon as possible. I would also invite members who are leaving the chamber, and indeed members of the public who are leaving the chamber, to do so quickly and quietly, please. I now call on Alison Johnstone to open the debate. Ms Johnstone, 7 minutes or thereby, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to debate Scotland's food future in this chamber today and thank colleagues who have made this possible by supporting the motion in my name. My motion highlights the work of the Scottish Food Coalition and its report, Plenty. The Coalition is made up of several organisations whose contribution to improving the health and well-being of people in Scotland is widely recognised and deservedly so. This is a landmark report, one that should be discussed far and wide, and then steps taken to implement. The report begins with the statement, "We have plenty of land in Scotland and plenty of sea and plenty of skilled people, scientists and innovators. There's no reason why we shouldn't have plenty of good food for everyone." Hear, hear. Now, it is absolutely the case that, as the report states, at the moment, our food system is characterised by inequalities and exploitation. Given the importance of food, it really is one of the few things we cannot live without, our food system should be founded on the principles of social and environmental justice. A food system founded on these principles would help enable us to address inequality, climate change, declining wildlife, animal welfare, and poor health. Now, there may be some who are of the view that business as usual is just grand, thank you very much, but if it is indeed the case that we are what we eat, then many people in Scotland are clearly not eating well. And in a country with plenty of land and sea, why is this the case? Why is it the case that 65% of people in Scotland are overweight or obese, and that in 2014-15, almost 120,000 people required emergency food aid, and almost a third of those were children? And this reliance on food aid takes place in a country which rightly celebrates its food and drink sector. Yet the focus is very much an export-based one, with much ado around whisky and salmon, despite the environmental damage that fish farms create in Scotland, to boost the profits of companies, many of whom are based outside the country. I'd like to see more of a focus on an agroecology approach, and one that invests more in growing our organic sector. Presiding Officer, 15% of Scottish households do not own cutlery. Such is the concern about our food culture that it's impacting terribly on our health, and leading consultants have coined a new term, diabesity, reflecting the relationship between obesity and diabetes. And this epidemic, which has a global reach and impact, also has a very local one. It costs health and happiness, and like demographic change and population increase, is putting our NHS budgets under increasing pressure. Now, corporations can and do make huge profits from dominating the food market, often with unhealthy food and unsustainable ways of growing and producing the food we eat. But the public purse pays for the pollution and the ill health. And lobbying at the highest levels of government has created the perverse logic needed for our leaders to think that international deals like TTIP are a good idea for our food system. But it doesn't have to be this way. We'll all be aware of amazing projects in our own communities. There's a fantastic collection of these projects in community energy in the Lothians region, connecting people to Scotland's true food future. There are community gardens taking over Granton street corners to create mini gardens, vegetable plots and communal meals. The Broomhouse Health Strategy Group, the Pilton Health Project, they're working with people on budgeting, on cooking skills, getting them more active in their daily lives and so much more. Crops and Pots is building a more rural feeling from concrete patches down in Leith. We can grow almost anywhere. The Cyrenians at the Royal Edinburgh Hospital and their Leith Fair Share depot and kitchen are doing an excellent job. They're helping people to learn to cook, to enjoy foods together, to appreciate all the wondrous things it can do.
I wonder if the member would give way.
Absolutely.
Ms Crawford.
Thank you, Alison, for giving way. I visited a fantastic project in my own constituency on Monday at Balfron, where they've got a food connections project trying to encourage the pupils to understand where their food comes from, how to cook it, and have now established a polytunnel where they're growing their own materials for the food for the kids to use. Do you think that sort of project should be exemplified throughout Scotland?
Alison Johnstone.
Yeah, I think I thank the member for raising the subject. I think that's a fantastic example of just making the best use of land everywhere. And if we can engage our pupils from the earliest age in our playgrounds, then what better use of space? So much space is unused and it could be productive. Musselburgh Transition Town, they're another example. They're working wonders with a wee community garden by the river. Edinburgh Community Food are building a network across the city. And there are many other groups doing a fantastic job providing emergency food relief. I'd like to mention too Transition Edinburgh South and the wonderful walled garden at Gracemount. And undoubtedly, there'll be many more that I've failed to mention. They are all working wonders. Food should help us grow. It should help us get well when we're not. It should make us feel good. Really nutritious food helps us keep well. It gives us the ability to deal with busy lives, no matter our age. It gives us personal resilience. And local food networks are vital to develop resilience at a community level. But we need to think about the future and about our ability to provide the food we need closer to home. I spoke yesterday in the land reform debate about smallholder tenant farmer Jim Telfer, who's in fear of losing the land he rents and his livelihood, as his land is the location of a speculative proposal for the film studio that's just been discussed in FMQs. Now, is his farm on poor quality land? No, it's on prime agricultural land. And this, I hope, will be recognised, valued, and the film studio built elsewhere. Obviously, Cumbernauld's been discussed, but Shawfair, which is nearby, has excellent transport links and a school that focuses on the creative industries. The local Damhead community have rallied round Jim, campaigning hard. And the vision they have for the land where they live is that it be formally recognised as Edinburgh's food belt. Think about urban crofts. Greenbelt land has never faced such development pressures, but we need to think about where the food citizens within and out with Edinburgh's Greenbelt will eat, where that food is coming from. And the food belt is a compelling idea, a much better way of thinking about the value of our Greenbelt and its benefits. Land in the food belt is a way to connect us to our food. Land here could have many more local businesses providing employment to people in cities and in more rural areas. For too many people, the Greenbelt is a patch of land you commute through without much thought. But we can rethink this land. I hope the Minister understands the power of ideas and also the power of money, because I learned yesterday that funding that has allowed Scotland's Food Coalition to form has been cut. In fact, completely removed, and that Nourish Scotland's funding has gone from £90,000 to nothing. Now, Nourish would like to tender for work.
Must draw to a close, please.
I will indeed, Presiding Officer. But it turns out that the only tender available to them is one that wraps up a massive amount of work on local food into a £3 million contract, which is inappropriate for small and medium enterprise bidders. So, in closing, Presiding Officer, I congratulate and thank all of those who are working to make us a better food nation, from our school dinner ladies to the Soil Association. Let's make sure that we're not just a well-fed, but a properly nourished population. And I'd be grateful if the Minister could address, in closing, the funding situation I outlined. Thank you very much.
Many thanks. Tight for time today. 4-minute speeches, please. Now Colin Malcolm Chisholm, to be followed by Christian Allard.
Presiding Officer, I congratulate Alison Johnstone on introducing the motion. Also, all the local groups mentioned in the motion, especially those based in my constituency, which I shall talk about in a moment. And finally, of course, the Scottish Food Coalition and their excellent report. It rightly emphasises the need to have the right to food in legislation. I hope that will be taken on board by the next Scottish Parliament. And it also emphasises core principles of environmental awareness and sustainability at the heart of production. Unfortunately, the reality is very different. Instead of a right to food, we have an increasing number of food banks and unacceptable food poverty. And this was highlighted in a recent report by the Pilton Community Health Project, which is mentioned in the motion. Their report, Good Food for All, found that poverty and food poverty are intrinsically linked. and that securing a fairer food system is very difficult in the light of very deeply rooted and persistent poverty. And that's, of course, why that excellent project, which I've known for over a quarter of a century, has always emphasised the importance of dealing with the broader determinants of poor health and health inequalities, but also, of course, has had excellent initiatives specifically on food and other lifestyle factors. But that report, which is certainly worth reading, also notes the rise in voluntary activity helping people to eat and eat well. And there are two excellent projects in my constituency which I want to highlight which do precisely that. And the first is in the North Edinburgh area, and they work not far from the Pilton Community Health Project, and they are the Granton Community Gardeners that Alison Johnson referred to. They are local residents who are growing fruit and vegetables in several garden plots, some of them on the corner of streets in the Granton area. And there's an interesting point actually in the report that Alison Johnson refers to in the motion from the Scottish Food Coalition, when they highlight the power of planning to ensure that vacant land is safeguarded for growing crops. And that is, I think, an important part of this subject as well. So there are a great many positives are connected with this food growing in Granton. There's an educational dimension to it. Many people learn how to grow food and learn other information about food. And in fact, the group had a 10-week course for local people specifically to encourage that knowledge. There's an opportunity to taste new fruits and vegetables, and it also builds up community cohesion as people talk to neighbours they may not have talked to before, as they work on the gardening, which of course is intrinsically healthy as well. They share meals with the produce, and the volunteers distribute the food to a large number of families and volunteers. And crucially also, it has a strong environmental dimension. The aims include, and I quote, encourage care for the environment and awareness of local wildlife and biodiversity. And this environmental dimension is also extremely important for Leith-based crops in pots, also mentioned in the motion. They educate people about the interaction between food and the environment, but even more important, put environmental sustainability into practice by growing food, planting trees, helping to reduce food waste, and encouraging dietary change to reduce environmental impact and improve health. Now, they're very grateful that they received climate change funding in the last and I think the previous round, and it's enabled them to build up a great team to establish infrastructure such as raised beds, sheds and a tree nursery, and build close relationships with the community. They've now put in another bid, and I do hope the Minister will look favourably on it, since it's absolutely crucial to the next stage of their development. Funding is essential to expand their community outreach, create habitats and, of course, continue to save carbon. For example, they work in local schools, they hold community events, and they are involving more and more people, increasingly more and more local people, but they do need to have the further round of climate challenge funding in order to keep their excellent work going.
Thanks. Now calling Christian Allard to be followed by Alex Johnston.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And I'll have to say I didn't sign the motion, and what's the reason I didn't sign it is because I read the report, which is a very, very good report. But for me, there is something missing. You know, we need to have a stronger emphasis on what where people are buying their food every day. They're buying them from the major retailer. We need to be a lot stronger on the major retailers and making sure not only that we've got better legislation like other countries have and better regulations, but that they sell local produce. And that's got to be, to my mind, at the center of everything we are talking about when we're talking about food. So that's the reason. I very much on the report, but I think there's not enough into this. But I would agree with Alison Johnson. I'm delighted that she brought it to Parliament. Let's take the statement that she talked about, which is right at the start. We have plenty of land in Scotland. We do. And with this Parliament, as Alison Johnson said, backing the Scottish Government Bill on land reform yesterday, more of this land will be used to grow food. And this is important, and that's really at the heart of it. She said as well, plenty of sea, and the statement says that. We do have plenty of sea. Scottish fish is back. I've been saying that for a long, long time. I've been working in the fishing industry for 30 years before coming to Parliament, but it's back both in quantities and in sizes. So after the fantastic effort of our fishermen the last 10 years, and if fantastic effort of this Parliament backing our fishermen, this Cabinet Secretary, and the Scottish Government backing the Cabinet Secretary. So there are good news there. But of course, comes in the statement, plenty of skilled people. That is important to realise as well. You know, our food industry in Scotland is part of our culture, is part of our universities, is part of our researchers. So we are very much apt to do this, not only for export, but for local as well. And we have fantastic experts in food production in this country, from farmers, fishermen, scientists, and innovators. And I do agree with the end of the statement when it says there are no reason why we shouldn't have plenty good food for everyone. The solution is always easy, Presiding Officer. People are always the solution. So we need to talk about people, and we need to understand more about food insecurity. And I met a lot of people in my own region. For example, Dave Summers is the chief executive of Committee Food Initiative Northeast, CFINE. And he's got a fantastic organization which developed more and more, and he's got all, he used to work for the Cyrenians. So he's been doing that for the last 40 years. So he knows really what the food issue is and poverty linked to it. And in Peterhead, he has now, since last October, the Fruit Mart, which is previously was in the village alongside, and the specialty shop is not only providing local produce as well, but he's got 17 people in the shop and is supporting employment guidance to address learning difficulties. So there's a lot happening in the countryside, there's a lot happening in our cities, and we really need to welcome that. Scientists are so important. Many of you will know, of course, Dr. Flora Douglas from the University of Aberdeen, who comes very often to this Parliament and is so passionate about what food is. And it's more than food, it's about our culture, about our society, and how we see ourselves. And on Tuesday night, there were Rob Gibson, MSP, who had Food for Thought, a fantastic event, where another expert, Charles Speer, the chair of the Food Commission, was talking about the work and outcomes involving the school programme. As a Food Commission, I will recommend everybody to read the interim report of the Food Commission. It's a very, very interesting read.
Draw to a close, please.
And by closing, what I would say is we need to have a different approach, and that approach got to involve everybody, involve businesses and our food producers. We need to buy local, buy Scottish, trust our farmers, trust our fishermen, trust our food producers, trust our experts, and we'll ensure that we'll have plenty good food for everyone. Presiding Officer.
Many thanks. I now call on Alex Johnstone to be followed by Sarah Boyett.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. I come to this debate from a slightly different point of view, having spent most of my life in the food production industry or the farming industry prior to becoming involved in politics. And the opening of this debate, Alison Johnstone used the phrase that here in Scotland there should be plenty of good food for everyone, and I couldn't agree more. Scotland's farming industry is one of the most efficient and productive to be found anywhere in the world. The intensive methods which are used are high output, low impact methods. We have the highest standards of animal welfare to be found anywhere on the planet, and we have a great deal to be proud of. That's why, while I have no wish to offend or cause any discord when others talk about organic methods, I don't object to organic farming, but what I do object to is the idea that somehow that method is better or more appropriate or worthy of greater support than the many traditional Scottish farmers using traditional Scottish methods to produce high-quality food, and I will always defend them. Yes, I will.
Alison Johnstone.
I'm sure the member will agree that organic actually is traditional, and I'm sure the member will agree that it actually could do with greater support in Scotland than it currently receives.
Alex Johnson.
I think it's important to realise that if a particular method is productive and worthwhile, it should do so in a competitive environment with other methods of farming. And we should demonstrate what is more effective by seeing what we actually achieve at the end of the day. However, let me continue. The truth is that there is a problem with food production and supply in Scotland, and it's not at the farming end. While there are problems associated with the returns that are gained from the marketplace, and we must work to achieve more on that front, we are extremely good at producing food. In spite of the fact that many of us can criticise the supermarkets for much of what they do, the supermarkets themselves do have an efficient method of distributing high-quality food to the marketplace. So the food goes... let me carry on. I've only got 4 minutes. Food is produced and it gets to the shops where people can buy it. The problem is that not all people can afford to buy it. And that's not caused by the cost of food. The truth is that food costs in terms of family income are about a tenth today what they were back in the 1950s. So food costs themselves are not the problem. The problem is that there are other costs that are in that family, these family costs that are causing distortions. For example, food is a relatively insignificant cost, yet housing costs are higher than ever. Fuel costs are high. Transport costs are high. So as a natural result of that, food quite often becomes a low priority, although it is a relatively low cost. And that's why so many of the organisations that have been mentioned today are so important to ensure that food is made available to those who find that food is the thing that drops off the table at the end of the day. As I said, I believe we have a good system in place, one that does not need to be radically reformed from the bottom up, but one which needs to be adapted to cater for the demands of that small minority who are currently suffering. I think the charitable sector does an enormous amount of good work, but we all know that that charitable sector should not be required to achieve these objectives. So while they do that good work and we praise them for it, let's find a way to ensure that in the future we can ensure that the best of Scotland's produce ends up in the hands of those who today, unfortunately, can least afford it.
Many thanks. Now call on Sarah Boyack, to be followed by John Wilson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And I do want to welcome the Coalition's important set of policy asks in advance of this next Scottish Parliament elections. And I think the fact that it's a combination and it's a coalition of environmental campaigners, anti-poverty campaigners, trade unions, farming and food producers does give us the impetus to think about food poverty, food quality and accessibility to food right across the political agenda, and to think through all the key policy levers that we need to be pulling and putting into place. I do just want to make a quick side note in thanking Alison Johnstone for getting this on our agenda today. I do want to wholeheartedly agree with her about the funding for the project work that Nourish has been doing. I think it is crucial in terms of bringing together that agenda, because it is cutting edge and it is setting a new agenda for the Scottish Government. I would be interested in the Cabinet Secretary's response in his closing remarks. I'm almost tempted to get sidetracked by responding to all of Alec Johnson's points, but I'm not going to go there today because it would get me too annoyed and I only have 4 minutes. I think this agenda is important because it's bringing together fairness and social justice and applying that to the food chain and applying that right across our communities. And it's totally appropriate that we're at the end of the Fair Trade fortnight. And there are so many interconnections that we could be making, focusing on the rights of workers and food growers in some of our most disadvantaged countries on the fair trade agenda and bringing that closer to home, thinking about the value we give to food, thinking about the principles of fairness and social justice. They absolutely need to apply in Scotland too, and I think that theme runs through Alison Johnson's motion today. It's good to see the Coalition arguing for fair pay for those who work in our Scottish agriculture and horticulture industries. They are some of our lowest paid workers across the country, and that's why Scottish Labour has campaigned so strongly, no thank you, for the Agricultural Wages Board to be retained in Scotland. It's been a crucial way of preventing the exploitation of vulnerable workers, whether isolated workers in our rural communities or the particular challenge of protecting migrant workers. has also been important in terms of the focus on health and safety, again, because these are isolated workers across our rural communities. And I think it's significant that Nourish and Unite have argued together the importance not just of retaining the Agricultural Wages Board, but the idea that we have a real living wage. Now, in yesterday's land reform debate, we were delighted to see that the Scottish Government picked up the agenda of the issue of human rights and food security. And that chimes very well with the motion we have in front of us today, putting food security in as human rights. And we now have the adoption of the International Convention on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights, the Voluntary Guidelines on Responsible Tenure of Land, Fisheries and Forests in the context of national food security. And I would argue that brings a new dimension to our food policy for the future. And that, I think, is our challenge going forward. And I want to welcome the work that's been done by Nourish and the Coalition to put this in a national context. I'd also argue very strongly that we need to make the connections at a local level as well. And I also want to celebrate the work that's been done by those local groups. In the Lothians as well, we have the Back Greens Initiative in Gorgie and Dalry, which have transformed people's back greens and tenements and brought residents together. I also want to welcome the Sustainable Food Cities Initiative and to link in the work that's been done by our allotment growing networks. And let's look at challenging what's done for the future. There's a lot of work that needs to be done. I would like to see food growing in our schools and our hospitals, linking into the eco-schools movement, the community orchards movement. We need to think about how we use our urban land, but we also need to think about empowering people to be able to grow food. The allotments and gardens movement is a key way in which we can do it, and we need to tie that into community empowerment, into health, and into that wider food growing movement, which I think will help us address the issue of affordable food and accessibility to food. And it's the interconnection between those range of issues that will deliver on the fantastic work being done by the Food Coalition. Thank you very much, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. Now call on John Wilson. Four minutes, please, Mr. Wilson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to congratulate Alison Johnstone for bringing this debate to the Chamber today, because it is a very important debate. I spoke recently in this chamber on the amount of food waste and questioned the corporate body in relation to food waste in the Parliament itself. But we know there is much more food waste taking place throughout the country, and that while some of that food could be used to be given to individuals and families, clearly there are other issues that need to be dealt with. And it's not just about giving leftovers to charities to patch up a failing system. It's about making sure the system works for everyone in society. As others have mentioned, Scotland is a resource-rich nation, and clearly, according to the Scottish Government, Scotland's current farmable land amounts to roughly 5.6 million hectares, which equates to around 71% of Scotland's total land area. And as an island nation, we are surrounded by sea, as others have mentioned, and we have large rivers and lochs that could provide plentiful food if we were actually to use those opportunities. But clearly, we have seen in terms of the debate today, and taken, as Sarah Boyack said, I wouldn't want to challenge Alec Johnstone here, but clearly there are issues in terms of what Alec Johnstone said and his contribution. But the issues we have got to identify, as well as the projects that have been identified by Alison Johnstone in her motion, there are a number of projects throughout Scotland who are working hard to try and make people aware of where the food on the plate comes from. But not only hard working to show them where it comes from, but encouraging them to start growing their own food. I recently visited a small project in Kirkshaws, and they have a few raised beds, one polytunnel, and they're actually bringing in school children and unemployed, bringing them in there to give them the opportunity to start growing their own food, own healthy food, and showing them where that food comes from. We've also got the legislation that was passed by this Parliament in terms of community empowerment, which said we wanted to see the increase in availability of land for allotments. And that is one way of taking forward the debate about people being able to not only access food, but access their own food, grow it, be actively involved in understanding what the production methods are involved in that. But there is another issue, Presiding Officer, and that's the procurement policies that currently exist in Scotland. I've just met with a group on Tuesday who told me that they still find it difficult to get into the procurement agenda, their produce, because of the way the system works. And if we can get local producers engaged in the procurement process that can supply to schools, hospitals and other public sector buildings, then clearly that would give the encouragement to develop those sectors and allow them to actively involve in producing locally produced, locally sourced, nutritious food. Comments have got to be made about the other people who are working in the sector and food production, and I'd like to pay tribute to John Hancock's, who's involved in the Commonwealth Orchard, and I have to say, a sponsor or co-sponsor the Parliament's Apple Day every September. And he has attempted on a number of occasions to get fruit trees grown in common space in schools and other areas to show children and adults that that food production could take place at a local level, and having those fruit trees in common space could actually help people just go along and help themselves to this nutritious fruit having to that fruit travelling halfway around the world to provide that. We have to be bolder in the delivery of opportunities for communities to have the resources to produce food locally, and we need to work together to ensure that works for the benefit of Scotland as a whole and end the situation with food poverty that currently exists in Scotland. Thank you.
Many thanks. Now call on Cabinet Secretary Richard Lockhead to close the debate on behalf of the Government.
Can I first begin by congratulating Alison Johnstone on securing this debate, which I think is a very welcome debate, very topical, it's timely, and I think it's another illustration of the growing importance we all attach to Scotland's food culture, our food systems, and indeed improving our food culture and improving our food systems in Scotland. And likewise, the report, which is the focus of Alison Johnstone's motion, which is Plenty, Food, Farming and Health in a New Scotland, published by the Scottish Food Coalition for a socially and environmentally just food system, is also timely and another sign of the momentum behind the food debate in Scotland. And I want to say to the authors of the report, it is a first-class report. I don't necessarily agree with absolutely everything in the report, and of course it's talking about ways in which we can change Scotland's food culture and our food systems, which is something that's not going to happen overnight, but certainly gives us many ideas of how we can get to a much better place in the future. And I very much support much of what is in this document. Indeed, at my party's conference at the weekend, I spoke at a meeting that was hosted by the RSPB and indeed Nourish, and there was a lot of common themes amongst all the speakers at that very well-attended event. It is indeed the case that as a country we celebrate our food and drink industry, our food and drink resources. We are a fantastic country when it comes to having the natural resources, the natural environment to produce the raw materials. We have our seas, we've got our fertile land at a time when the rest of the planet is running out of fertile land, and we have the men and women with the skills to take the raw materials and turn it into fantastic produce, which people want to enjoy in this country and indeed overseas as well. So that brings an important economic value, and yes, exports are an important part of that success. But it would be unfair, just to point out in terms of what Alison Johnstone said at one point, to say that Scottish food policy is all about exports and big business and salmon and whisky. They're immensely successful industries, and after all, if we want people to be able to afford to buy food, they need jobs, and we have those economic strengths, so we should make the most of them in Scotland. But a huge emphasis of Scottish food policy over the last few years has been on the other dimensions of food policy, which is the environmental impact, particularly at a time we want to achieve our climate change targets. Also tackling the irony that we have all this nutritious food, we're able to produce their own doorstep, but we have the record-breaking diabetes statistics or obesity statistics that we wish we didn't have at a time when we have all this healthy food, but people are not enjoying it. And of course, at the same time, we have food poverty in Scotland, which is a mark of shame. And of course, the UK's austerity agenda is largely responsible for where we are with that at the moment. And I likewise, like many other members, want to congratulate the many community initiatives across Scotland and charitable efforts that are taking place to ensure that people can access food at their time of need. And clearly the answer to that is to make sure that people can afford to buy their own food in the first place, and the Scottish Government is also bringing forward funding to help those initiatives. But even if you look at local food, that is something that is undergoing a revolution in Scotland at the moment, and again is being supported by the Scottish Government. We gave over £2 million between 2013 and 2016 to support many local initiatives across the country. Indeed, 140 initiatives have been supported through that kind of funding, ranging from community food initiatives to make sure people can access food grown locally to food festivals and other food events taking place. And they're very important in terms of supporting the local food revolution that's taking place in Scotland. Yeah.
John.
Thank you. I'm grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for taking the intervention. You mentioned all these small community projects, and they're tremendous, and the aggregate effect can be very impressive. What part should planning policy play in food production? For instance, should the government not be allowing good agricultural land to be used for building?
Well, planning policy should play a role, and I welcome the fact that many of the initiatives mentioned by members during this debate have actually been put forward and supported and originated from the Scottish Government. So, for instance, planning policy and allotments is an issue that came out of a meeting I had with a Fife council official a few years ago, when he was telling me the difficulties they had in Fife of securing land for allotments, and we've managed to now change the legislation in Scotland to deal with those sort of issues, and planning policy is at the heart of that. There's two or three issues I just want to touch upon briefly before I close, which other members have raised. Firstly, food waste. Again, one of the ironies is that people can't afford or are able to access good quality food at a time when, as a society, we waste a lot of food. And that is a crazy place to be, given the impact it has on our pockets for households and their budgets, as well as the fact it's bad for the environment and it's just a simple waste of a very valuable resource. The 2012 regulations we passed in this Parliament now mean that there are measures in place to stop food waste going to landfill. At the same time, we have now set Europe's most ambitious target as a government to cut food waste from Scotland by a third from 2025, and we're taking a European lead in terms of tackling food waste. At the same time, it's also, of course, a global issue. At a time when people talk about GM, which this government does not support as the answer to feeding more mouths in the world, as a way to produce more food, as a planet, the UN report that we waste around a third of the food we produce in the world, and about 28%, if I remember the statistic correctly, of our agricultural land is used to grow food that's wasted, 28%. So clearly, to tackle food poverty or malnutrition around the world, we have to also tackle food waste in a global sense as well as in a Scottish sense. And the final point I just want to make is, or two quick points, is in terms of tackling all these issues at a European level, I do agree the common agricultural policy needs reformed. Indeed, if it was up to me, we'd rename it a European food policy and address other dimensions within that. And the final point I want to make is that food education, which some members have mentioned, is also crucially important. It is not good enough that our young people don't know where the food on their plate comes from, how it was grown, the impact it has on the environment, and most importantly, of course, the impact it has on their health. Only last week, I announced about £870,000 of new money for food education initiatives in Scotland. I was at Holyrood High School here in Edinburgh doing that, and that cash over the next year will support many food education initiatives working with teachers and staff and pupils in many of our schools. And over 300,000 pupils have already benefited from Scottish Government food education money over the last few years as well. So food education is key to changing Scotland's food systems, our food culture, and creating a good food nation in this country.
Many thanks, and thank you all for taking part in this important debate. And I now suspend this meeting until 2:30.